Hello and welcome. My name is Architect Russell and this is
Dr. Harrison Yesayam Sangi.
Today we're going to talk about the difference between an architect and a doctor. Architecture or a doctor. If you're making a decision on becoming a doctor or architect, you can't make that decision, or you just want to know what the difference is between an architect and a doctor, then this is the place. We've got 10 questions we're going to ask. The same kind of question for each person, so you'll get a difference of what the career is like and the differences between the two careers. So let's start off with the first question. What inspired you to become a doctor, Mzangi?
Yeah, from my childhood, when I was a kid, I was aiming to become a doctor because I was seeing like sometimes my family, my relatives getting sick. And then I was like, if we go to the hospital, I see some doctors working there. Actually, in my family, nobody is a doctor. I'm the first doctor in my clan, in my family, you know.
That's some achievement.
Yes. So I was aiming at helping people and help sick people. Seeing like if somebody is sick, somebody is having pain. And then after a doctor prescribed a certain medication, a certain medicine, there's the patient is improved. So that was my motivation. I'm enjoying it.
That's fantastic. Yes.
And what made you to become an architect? What was the motivation?
Oh, it first started at school. My design teacher at school said I had a talent for design, and I was always good at drawing.
Okay.
And I liked doing technical drawing. Not many people did like technical drawing apart from me.
Okay.
And I had a choice. I was going to continue doing art, design and technology, and I had to drop one of them, so I dropped art and took design technology. And then my teacher said I had a talent, and then I couldn't decide what to choose. And then I went on holiday with my parents to New York, and I saw all these buildings, and I started drawing a few buildings, so that kind of got me in. But like, I never had that thing, oh, I always wanted to be an architect. It was never that. It kind of just, I didn't know what else to choose. I just went for it, really. And as over the years, you kind of just decide you're going to go all the way, and then you do it. For me, it was a gradual process being inspired. I kind of got more inspired the longer I studied it. Like, the teacher would inspire you, and then you go visit buildings. So it was a gradual thing. Oh, it wasn't just like that.
That's great. Sounds great. So you have talked about talent. Does being an architect need to be... Somebody needs to be talented on architect?
No.
Or somebody can just come from wherever and become an architect just by reading and from school?
No, I don't think so. You need to have creativity and stuff, but I'm sure we'll talk about that later. But I think hard work equals talent. Talent doesn't come naturally, I don't think. Not all the time.
Okay.
Sometimes it does, but I don't think it doesn't have to be talent, I don't think.
Okay, so if you want to become an architect, you must know how to draw. That is necessary.
Yeah, but you don't have to be good at drawing.
Okay.
I suppose you have to be creative.
Creative.
I guess you have to have some little bit of talent, but I think
if you're
not good in one area like drawing, I think you can build that up and improve it, I think.
Yeah. Like in our career, we have different kind of doctors. We have good doctors and we have also bad doctors. Yes. So some of them, they don't have that spirit of being a doctor or a talent.
Is it a talent or is it passion?
Passion? But it's a bad doctor just because he or she does not have a passion. And I don't know if I should term it as a talent, but you have to be
passionate.
Because
same for an architect, you need a license to be a doctor. You need a threshold of education to be a doctor, and you need a threshold of education to be a licensed architect.
Yes.
So you still, even if you're a doctor, they can't be that bad because they're still past that level. So they're still
at that level. They can prescribe medications.
But it can still be bad or good.
Yes, but sometimes they can just neglect patients. They don't care, you know, because they don't have that passion. So that makes a bad doctor. And sometimes they can just prescribe a medication without having that ethical background of that prescription, you know. Some of them, they've studied doctor of medicine and finished, but they don't practice. They've gone to other issues.
Get that
business
with,
and stuff. So
you get that with architects as well.
So some the passion should be there.
Some architects, they're more business orientated. They just be directors or they run the business as well.
Yeah, so we have that. So that's all about the career.
So on to the next question.
Uh-huh.
what are the, some of the unique challenges you face in your professions? I'll start off with this one now. Striking the difference between creativity and practicality, especially here in Tanzania, it's very practical. You can't go over this extreme. You're not going to get Zaha Hadid or Frank Gehry designing in Dar es Salaam, that's for sure. So a lot of the designs I do are quite practical, really. You have to think. You don't just draw a line and that's it. You have to think how that's going to be built when you're designing it. That's how you know a good architect from a bad architect. They design something, they know how it's going to be constructed. So you gotta understand the practicality of building it in the area, in the country, or where you are. That's important. Easy enough to do a pretty design, but to actually understand how it's been built. So that's the thing, balancing to make it look pretty and fantastic, but without blowing the budget and without the client screaming at you, that's too expensive, but you have to make sure he likes it as well. Sometimes they just want something simple, so you got to strike that balance, really. I personally have a challenge with materials here, because it's a developing country, so procuring the materials is difficult, and constructability is difficult here compared to developed countries.
Okay.
So a lot of materials are not available here, so you have to import them, then it's expensive and take time, and you have to find the right material that in stock and all that stuff. Tears my head out that. So you might choose something, but it might not be available here, so you have to find a substitute. Communicating with other consultants, that's challenging. You have to communicate with a lot of people. Make sure the design is coordinated, it has all the engineering components, plumbing, electrical, mechanical structures, all those things. Interior sometimes, or landscape design, you got to make sure it fits within your design, so you have to coordinate with a lot of people.
Okay.
And then also keeping up to date with all technology and stuff as well. So, trends and the latest things, latest technologies. I'm sure we'll have a question on that later.
So may I ask you, do you get a challenge? Like sometimes you have designed something and you have given that to the engineer, because you have to design and then you give some people to implement what you have designed. Does it commonly occur you have designed something and these people implement something else?
No, they're just putting their components to it. It's like structural engineer will put the columns, beams, it's like the skeleton of the building. They won't be interested in windows and stuff, like, so they're making it sure it stands up.
But everything that you have designed should be exactly the same that they should put the physical.
You gradually get their input, so you're adding their bits to the design as it goes on, and that develops more and more.
Okay.
So it will change a bit with their input. They don't change the overall design.
No,
it's the architect.
It should be the same. Okay.
It might change after their input, but you kind of have to control that. What challenges do you face?
Yeah, there's a lot. As you have said, we are working in a developing country like Tanzania and Africa. So sometimes we are having this challenge of having limited resources. You may have a patient, you want this patient to have investigation, maybe CT scan or MRI, and you find that this patient is very poor, and some of them, they are not insured. We have the problem here in Africa, not everyone is insured with the health insurance. So sometimes you get stuck because you want to attend that patient, you want to know, because as a doctor, I cannot just treat by just taking the history and physical examination. Sometimes I need a baseline investigations. So sometimes I'm facing a challenge to treat this patient because of financial issues.
They don't have enough money.
Yes.
So how does that work? If they can't afford a scan, do they just not have the scan and then...
Yes, and how can I treat that patient? Because my number one duty is to save life.
Oh my God.
So if I don't know the patient is sick, maybe is having a mass in the abdomen, how can I know that this is a mass if I don't do biopsy, I don't do MRI, CT scan?
And they don't take it.
Yeah, most of them they die before we get the diagnosis, the proper diagnosis. So that's number one challenge. But speaking of poverty, it's a broad from the patient perspective, but also from the hospital perspective. the healthcare, the patient care, because also we don't have some facilities. Some of the hospitals, they don't have theaters, they don't have ultrasound, so all that.
I went to one that didn't have like a scanning machine.
The only
scanning machine was in another country.
Yes, so that's number one. Number two, so in Africa, you know, it's different from Europe and America, you know. The payment that we're getting as a doctor are actually very low, but we are working because we have a passion, we keep on going. That's number two. Number three, sometimes we work a lot. We have no time, man. Even sometimes for booze, we don't have time.
Always make time for booze, Dr. Mazangi.
For you guys. You see now? So sometimes there's no time to sit with friends, sometimes with the family, you know? Being busy, working, you know, sometimes 24 hours, 48 hours, keep on working, you know, saving lives. Actually, in Africa, in most African countries, the ratio of doctor to patient is very big, you know. One doctor can attend even 50 patients per day, sometimes more than that.
Wow.
Yeah, a lot of patients. So it's a good way that we can link and communicate among ourselves. Yeah, because here
within doctors,
yeah, because here everybody is doing his thing, you know. We don't have that communication. We have our organizations that we sometimes we meet, but not much. So that's another challenge. Yeah, I think those are the main unique challenges that we're facing here.
Since you mentioned salary, how much does an architect and doctor get paid? You can go onto the RIBA website. They tell you a salary survey. You can see everything there. I'll put it up here. So most you can get roughly in the UK is around £69,000. That's a very extreme. That's like a director in London. Yeah, but that's before tax. But after tax, you'll get 30% less than that. But it ranges. It can start from when you graduate. It could start from £20,000 or $20,000, and then go all the way up to your 15 to 20 years post-registration experience. It can just keep going up. So you might get a bad salary from the beginning when you become an architect, but over the years, it does get up. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of complaints though that architects don't get paid much for how much they study.
Mm.
A lot of architects complain about that, but I think they don't realize that it does go up after you got a lot of experience. Or if you're not happy, you can move country like I did. So, doctor's salary.
For a medical doctor, particularly in Tanzania, for doctors, you know, we have categories, yeah? We have a doctor who has a first degree, for which we call them GP or general practitioners.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so for this one, roughly, even in Africa, there's a very big variation. If you go to countries like Botswana, countries like even Kenya, they're paying very good. It's compared to Tanzania.
South Africa.
Yeah. Oh my God.
They have the biggest hospital in Africa.
Yeah, big hospitals. So in Tanzania, we are not complaining, but we are paying very low. Yeah. So the range is between USD 560. 500, 660.
$560.
Per month.
I need per year because to compare
per year.
It. 560 times 12.
Uh-huh, times 12.
Oh, what the fuck? No way. $560 times 12.
Yes.
Oh, that's only $6,000.
Yes.
What the hell?
That's a minimum. And this one...
That isn't even minimum wage.
Yes, man. Yes, man. You can imagine.
Countries.
And this person has been in class, struggling, reading. Having no time for booze, no time for girlfriend, no
I
time for...
I spent $6,000 on booze alone.
Oh my goodness. You know, this is not a joke. We're talking this very serious. And
that's disgusting, isn't it?
Yes, very little.
Developing countries for
it's
you.
It's a developing country,
oh,
but
dear.
Things should be changed. Mm-hmm. I want to tell you, my friend, this one is basically a gross salary.
Before tax. Oh my God.
Before the social security fund and stuff.
Oh my God.
And if God has blessed you, you have gone for your second degree, become a specialist, And then that one will go up a little bit, up to maybe $1,600 USD.
Per month.
Per month. So that so you can calculate that one is how much per year.
Roughly nearly $20,000 a year.
Yes. And then that's...
So that's roughly what I was getting in the UK when I... Oh, my first degree, yeah. Mm.
So that one can go up to $2,500 USD, the range, yeah?
And what about in a developed country? Do you know anything about that?
Not much, but I think they are paid very good, very good.
I can ask ChatGPT, Upper England.
Maybe in England, yeah.
Ranges from £60,000 to £90,000 per year. Everyone knows generally a doctor earns more than an architect.
Should be like that, yeah. So that's how it should be. Yeah.
And since we just finished salaries, let's go on to education. How long to be a doctor? How long to be an architect?
Yeah. Yes.
How long to be a qualified doctor? So that's GP, is it?
Yes, that's GP from university. Yeah. First of all, basic education, that is O level and A level.
Yeah.
And then from university, 5 years.
So do you do 5 years straight?
No working.
Straight.
And then you should have 1 year.
Working
as an intern doctor.
Okay.
An intern doctor for 1 year. So total of 6 years. And then you get your...
Exams. Take exams and then pass.
You first, after 5 years, you have to do an exam before you join internship program.
Okay.
For 1 year. And then you do another exam to have... You have temporary registration by the council. So you become a doctor, you start practicing.
Okay.
For 2 years, and then you become a full, like, permanent registrar. We call it registrar.
Ah.
Yes.
Oh, so you get temporary and then permanent. Oh, I didn't know
temporary,
that.
Temporary, 6 years.
To be a temporary doctor, then 7-8 years to be a permanent one.
Permanent.
That's if you do it straight.
That is.
Do you get people who take longer?
Yes.
Yeah.
If you have issues with your education, maybe at the school,
did you do everything? It straight?
Yeah, for me I did straight. Oh, yes.
Good boy then. I didn't.
You didn't?
Uh-huh. How long does it take to study to be an architect? How uh-huh. many times have I said this?
Uh-huh.
3 years uh-huh. Degree.
Only 3 years?
You then work for at least 1 year.
Uh-huh. Then four.
Then study for another 2 years.
Okay. Study another 2 years.
Then work for another 1 year.
Okay.
Then you can take exams and become licensed.
Okay.
So 5, 6, 7 years.
7 years. So for us it's 6. So I think you're going, you're studying.
But
more.
Then you've got temporary and permanent. So yeah, ours is longer actually.
Yeah, it's longer.
So architect studies longer than
longer.
A doctor.
Yes. You see now?
No, not study longer. I mean, the process is longer, I think.
The process is longer.
So you do 5 years full-time study.
Full-time.
Same with us.
Five years. But you say it's 3.
3 plus another 2.
Ah, okay.
So you'd work.
But how? Why do you divide them 3 and then 2?
You don't know what's going on. The university designing is a hell of a lot different than practical working.
Okay.
Yes, otherwise you get a big shock. Oh, shit,
yeah,
this is reality.
I can imagine.
You're designing donuts for 5 years, then you go, what? Oh. No donuts.
Okay. But for us, if you want to become a specialist, you need to add 3 years. Of which we're gonna choose if you want to be a physician, if you want to be obstetrician and gynecologist, or if you want to be an orthopedic surgeon, if you want to be a general surgeon.
You have to study again?
3 years.
Another 3 years. Oh my goodness.
To specialize. And if you want to be a super specialist, you go specifically to a certain thing, you have to go another 2 years.
Is that what you're doing at the moment? That's what you're doing now.
Yes, that's what I'm doing. So, 5 years plus
then
one.
You get
six.
The mega bucks.
Yeah, and then
three. Are you going to leave the country to get mega bucks?
No. That's not a plan. We want to help people, you know. We are doing all that.
No, I mean, be a doctor in another country, get more money.
More money, yeah, money, yeah. We are looking for money, yeah. But our first motivation is to save life. And for you guys, if you want to become, to have a master's in ACTEC, is it possible?
I have a master's.
You have master's?
Yeah, includes master's. It's like 3 years.
So how many years?
It's like 3 years. Master's was another 1 year. I got like, throughout my studies, I got a BA honours degree, I got a diploma, and I got a master's. So it's like having 3 degrees or that.
Three?
Yeah. Or 2.5. Yeah.
2. Okay.
Some architects, depending on what course they do, they don't have a master's.
Mm. But if you have a first degree and you have your master's, will that add a value?
For me, it's just the registration, the license.
Just registration.
And it doesn't really care what degree you got, as long as you got the license at the end of it, because you need all that to get the license.
Yeah.
Right, next question. What advice would you give to inspiring doctors or architects or those considering a career? Okay, I'll go to you first.
Uh-huh. 3 things I will tell. Over 10 years experience being a doctor.
That's impressive.
That's impressive. I've never gone to Europe or America, but in Africa, I know what's really going on here. So I would actually advise, number one, to study hard. You know, medicine needs somebody to study very hard in the primary, then O-level, then A-level, and then to the college. Yeah, to the university, to study very hard so that you can finish and to have knowledge. Yeah, that's number one. To have a passion. Because sometimes medicine or being a doctor is challenging, but also rewarding. So, passion.
You
should have a passion to it.
Do you like it?
Yes, that's what I'm doing. So, a passion, and then you have to work hard, and then you have to dedicate yourself. Dedication. Dedicate yourself to the career, and then you have to put all your life in that career. So, because medicine sometimes will require you to work overnight, sometimes you don't sleep.
24 hour shift,
sometimes 48, sometimes more than that. So you have to be determined, you have to be passionate, you have to be hardworking, you have to be ready to listen and to learn. And medicine actually is a continuous process. Every day people are doing research, people are developing new guidelines. So you have to be ongoing reading and reading and reading. For you?
What advice would I give inspiring architects?
Architect.
I think 4 things.
4 things.
It's a very dynamic field. So you gotta wear several hats.
Okay.
It's like, it's a science, it's an art. You've gotta be creative, you've gotta be technical. You gotta work with a lot of people. You gotta manage your time. So you gotta do a lot of things. You gotta be good on the computer. You gotta be able to communicate your ideas across easily using whatever medium you want. Like you've got to be creative, make models and stuff, but you also understand a bit of engineering, technical side of it, practicality. So it's a lot of different things. But I suppose it never gets boring though. So that's the first thing. Second thing would be you've got to be open to ideas. Get ideas from other people. I get ideas from other people. Like my boss gives me loads of ideas.
Yeah.
Even other people in the office, even tell your friends about your design, they might give you ideas. So you can't just stick to your idea and then think it's right, because it's never going to be right half the time. You got to, you know, 2 minds are better than 1, 3 minds are better than 1. You might be going down this road and might think, oh, I've just drawn something, it looks fantastic, but to you it might be okay, but you might look at it for 2 months and think it's great, but then someone might just look at it and tell you it's shit straight away. So you got to be open to criticism, basically.
Okay.
And then
that's good.
I kind of mentioned it, you have to be creative and technical. So bear that in mind. So when you're at school and stuff, even to get into university, you have to choose subjects that are a bit creative and a bit technical. So like technical would be like maths or physics. But then you have to show that you've done something creative, like art or design or communication, graphics. So you got to show that even before you go to university, you got to prove that.
Okay.
And that goes on throughout the career. So you got to have those 2 things. And then lastly, embrace collaboration. You got to work with other people. I find this difficult because I like to do a lot of things myself. But don't be afraid if you got another architect to work with, then collaborate them. You get better ideas, like I was saying. Embrace working with other people. So those 4 things. You got to bear in mind if you want to become an architect. And finally, icing on the cake, you got to like it. You got to enjoy it, otherwise you'll never get by. You got to be passionate, as you said. This is a quote from Norman Foster, like one of the most famous architects in the world. He just said, do you really, really want to do it?
That's ask what yourself, says. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, now the next question. Mm-hmm. Can you describe the role of technology in modern architecture or medicine? And how has it impacted clients or patients? So for me, software, building information modeling, that's made everything easier and quicker and streamlined the process, made everything more accurate. BIM is when you model the building in 3D and you insert objects that they're real objects, like you insert a door in 3D, you insert a wall in 3D. Mm-hmm. You're not just drawing a dumb object, you're creating a 3D model of the building and you're inserting a door. Okay. And the door has information like how big it is,
okay,
what the material of it is, how many there are in the building. A wall will show what it's made of, how thick it is, and the volume of it, it'll all be inside this digital model. Then you can pull out all the information. We never had this like 15 years ago, so that's improved everything about communicating to the client, communicating to the contractor, getting price, everything. So
everything
that's pretty standard in the industry now. And also software allows you to create different shapes and geometry and algorithms. You get all these different software doing Zaha Hadid stuff, crazy stuff which you don't get in Tanzania. So it allows architects to be more creative and doing these funny geometry shapes and those kind of things, twisting and repetition and so that's improved a lot, and it allows you to communicate to the client, and you've got VR and stuff now. The next one's going to be artificial intelligence, making designs more efficient. A lot of these digital processes on the computer will be, the simple tasks will be obsolete now. Humans won't have to do them, so repetitive tasks will be done by AI in the future. AI's helping with ideas, coming up with ideas. I'm using it now. You describe a building you want and they'll give you an image of it, and then you kind of use that and then you develop that. Able to communicate with clients and people as well. ChatGPT I'm using now. If you've got a question, you can, that's quite normal nowadays. And then sustainability as well, like technology. Mostly it's been software for me as an architect, because software is the key in the office. So software's allowed sustainability to be more streamlined. You can do a model of the building, how much energy it's going to produce, shading, if it's going to get cool or hot. You can do all that now, so that's helped streamline the sustainability that's been pushing around the world to protect the environment. Then lastly, the construction as well, technology during construction. There's stuff like 3D printing and robotics on site, building the building automatically. This helps speed the process of construction and makes it cheaper as well. So all this technology is helping communicate with the client. You like VR, helmet and stuff like that. You can communicate to the client and shapes, break the boundaries of shapes during design. And then construction, it's more speeding up the process and making it cheaper to build.
Okay.
So how about you, Mzangi? Can you describe the role of technology in modern medicine and how it's impacted the patients?
Okay, in technology and advancement, technology has impacted positively towards patient care in four aspects. Number one, in terms of diagnostics. You know, previously we used to treat patients just by history. I just ask you and then I do physical examination and then my knowledge will tell me Russell is sick of a certain disease just by knowledge. But nowadays, because of advancement of technology, I can do investigations, diagnostic investigations, so that I can confirm what I was thinking, if it is true or not.
Okay.
So nowadays we have this advancement in technology that will help us to know that if I think you have a mass or a tumor in your chest, I can do CT scan, and then CT scan will come and then say this is a tumor, and then I'll take you to interventional radiology. We'll go there and pick a sample from that mass and go to the laboratory and do investigation to say this is a tumor, is it a malignant or benign, If it is a malignant, what kind of malignance? So we go up to there because of this advancement. So in terms of diagnostics, the technology has done wonders in the medical field. So that's number one. So in terms of diagnostic means to help the doctor to know the diagnosis.
Okay.
What are you suffering from?
Yeah.
Oh, this patient is suffering from what? That's number one. But number two, to treat. I've already established the diagnosis. This patient is sick of this. Now this diagnosis will help me to treat this patient. Technology has helped us as doctors to treat properly, because nowadays you can even if your heart or a patient's heart is failing and that patient has no any other option rather than dying, nowadays you can do a heart transplant. You transplant a heart and that patient will continue to live.
What about brain?
Brain, that's a question. But we have heart transplant, kidney transplant, very common, even now in Tanzania. You can imagine now in Tanzania we do kidney transplant. But you also, you can have liver transplant, you can have lung transplant.
In Tanzania?
Not in Tanzania, kidney, we can transplant. Kidney is failed, end stage, then somebody who is your relative can donate and then you can continue your life.
What other transplants can they do in Tanzania?
In Tanzania, no. Just only that kidney. Renal. Kidney.
Is it possible to do kidney. Brain transplant? Can we swap brains, architect, doctor?
Another possibility
new
for
technology.
Scientists. Yes, scientists can investigate and can do research and maybe something like that can happen, you know?
I would like to do it just for one day though.
Just for one day.
And then put back.
So that's possible, you know? So advancement in technology, it can...
So is a brain transplant
it's not,
possible?
No, not yet. But heart transplant, lung transplant, liver transplant, kidney transplant, all that can be done. You see, that's advancement. But also software. Now we can put our records, put in the computer, everything is recorded. Next time you come, I can trace. Russell came to me. What was the problem, and they can use that information to treat you more.
You don't spend much time on the computer, do you, doctors, do you think?
Yes, but nowadays, if you don't spend much time in a computer, you cannot do anything, because everything is on a computer nowadays. Everything is soft-kitted, you know?
But you don't need software you use, it's pretty basic, is it?
It's just basic, yeah.
You don't need to know advanced software?
No, not advanced. Just basic, you know how to put the information in the computer, that will help. But we have this telemedicine, robotics, all that is advancement in technology.
Now, next question. Sustainability is a hot topic. So for me, sustainability, Mzangi, is not just saving energy, it's health and well-being, it's also saving water, and also efficiency, so saving money. How does sustainable design affect your role at work, and what impact does it have on the communities?
So I would like an architect to respond to that first.
Oh, really? So sustainability is a big aspect in my job nowadays. Government's always pushing to save energy, save water, look after health and well-being of people, efficiency. So efficiency is a big one. I mentioned before in the where I work, Tanzania. So saving energy, shading, those kind of things. Water, there's loads of ways to improve water. I'm not going to try, I just touch on this stuff briefly. Collecting rainwater, having efficient tap fittings and shower fittings so the water doesn't run fast enough. Health and well-being of people, it's like natural ventilation, nice daylighting views, filters on the AC, make sure every occupied space has fresh air. I went into a hospital here, there's a doctor in one of the rooms, it didn't even have a window. It just had air conditioning in it. No fresh air at all.
No fresh air.
I said to him, this is unhealthy. You're a doctor, you're in this room.
That can be a risky. Like, if a patient with TB, tuberculosis, that patient can infect.
So that's just touched on health and well-being. And then efficiency, my God, here, I'm always pushing for efficiency. So you don't have any wasted space in the building, basically, it's all being used. You don't want any wasted space. Like if you do an office or something, you have a rentable space, so the non-rentable space is as small as possible. That makes it efficient. Or if you're using materials, you don't want to use something too expensive that you can have an alternative. You've got to judge what's efficient and what's practical, basically. So all those things for me are sustainability.
Sustainability,
really.
Okay. Sounds very good. Yeah.
But you must have ways of saving energy at work or saving water.
Obviously,
or
your health and well-being, you're a doctor.
Mm-hmm.
How do you make things more efficient? How do you mm-hmm. work more efficiently?
Mm-hmm.
How do you save water at work? Do you think about those things or not?
Well, actually, in our practice, especially in Africa, you know, we really care. We really consider how well we can help this patient. Because here, most of the patients are poor. Even in our training, we are trained to do everything in efficiency, in a way that you can help this patient. Because most of them, they are paying from their cash, even if the insurance is paying.
Efficiency is a really
efficiency.
Big thing. Yeah.
Yes.
Especially in this country.
Especially, yeah, in this country, yeah. Even if a patient is having insurance, the insurance can be traumatized if you misuse. So everything that we do, we are very conscious. We are very conscious. This really needs to be done now.
And do you think about not just the patient's money, but do you think about the bills of the hospital? Like,
yes. The bills of the hospital,
electricity,
electricity and other thing. But even though for us we are in the clinical part, we have the other people who are dealing with administration and management of the hospital. They are doing their job.
They push you.
Sometimes they push us, but not much. But they do their work. But for us, our concern is about the patient. We don't have to spend too much for the patient for the maybe investigations or polypharmacy. There's a thing which you call it polypharmacy. The doctor is prescribing maybe 10 different medications that some of them, they are not necessary to be given to the patient. So we ethically, it's not good. We are very sensitive about that. We are very conscious about that. But also about water in Africa, not much. People are not concerned about water conservation. But in some places, they are very, especially in private hospitals.
You've seen many sustainable features in your hospitals, like an open courtyard with a garden, people walk around, or
these, let's say, from the current ones that are new built, yeah? I think most of them they observe. Muimbili Mloganzila Hospital, which is a new, it's not very new, but it's a modern hospital. Very well built, and we have these private rooms that are very big, ventilated, and they are very good.
Windows, big windows,
and very nice furniture and everything. So even the patients are enjoying. So we are trying, especially in Africa and Tanzania, we are trying to observe this sustainability issue. And I can say we are basically trying our best.
Recycling, you come across recycling.
Recycling in Africa is very minimal. Yeah, we are trying to do, but very minimal. Most of them, we don't do recycling, especially in the medical field, not much.
Next question, how do you stay up to date with all the advancements and trends in the field?
A doctor should always be updated. That's number one, that's the key. If you want to become a good doctor, you have to be updated. Every day you have to read, you have to go to the internet, you have to go to seminars, workshops, a lot of stuff. So number one is update, because the way I treat you with malaria today is different the way another doctor will treat you about the same malaria after 1 year or
wow.
6 years. Yes,
wow.
Yes. So you have
advances.
Yes. The way I treat a patient with heart failure today will be different from after 6 months or maybe 1 year.
What about erectile dysfunction? Does that advance treatment?
Yes, every day. People, the good thing about medicine, scientists, they are busy working, doing research, finding new ideas and advancement
in
technology.
That's crazy, I didn't realize. Yeah,
yes, it's different.
Yeah.
It's mobile, it's something that is not stagnant, something that is keep on changing every day.
Does that knowledge get passed around the world quickly?
Nowadays, the good thing is we have the internet. So people are doing research. In medicine, everything should be done according to research. And after research,
you make sure it's up to date.
And then you make sure you publish so that a person in South Africa should see, a person in Brazil will see.
Publish.
And you publish in the recognized platforms.
But you can't do that with every single patient.
Standard of treatment, patient care, let's say diabetes mellitus or hypertension or malaria or pneumonia. So if I go to the internet and then I want to know what is new, and then I say, Dr. Russell has done this research and this were the results and this were the conclusion from the evidence that Dr. Russell did. And then I can say, okay. So instead of giving this medication, I can give this in this dose for this time, you know, from the research that Dr. Russell has done, you see? So that's how medicine is evolving every day. Yeah. We have like more than 10,000 diseases in the world. So I need to know, because every time the patient will come to me with a new disease, and every patient is unique. Patient X is presenting with malaria is different from patient Y would present with the same malaria. So if I just cram patient Y with malaria presenting with this patient X, I will not be able to treat. So there's different presentation of this, the same disease, but every patient is unique. So that's what I can tell them for now.
So my turn then.
How do you keep up with your technology?
You probably have similar thing. I have to do CPD, which stands for continued professional development.
Yes.
Which you do online. CPD. I have a certain amount every year. I think it's 35 hours, half of which has to be structured, which means formal lecture or formal being taught formally. And then half of it can be around research. So you have to do at least that every year. So structured continued professional development is stuff like they have official videos online you can watch now. You can watch that educate you on new technologies and what's out there, or ways of designing and things like that. Or you can go to official lectures from manufacturers or other architects and stuff. That all counts as structured being taught something basically in your field. So you should do that every year.
Yes.
Or
exactly.
Or this casual stuff, non-structured CPD, which is just reading, watching like a documentary or something.
Yes.
Reading architectural journal.
Yeah.
Just my favorite is going to visit buildings in different countries. I like to do that.
Yes. Very good.
It's my favorite. Talking to other architects or people in your field about different ways of designing or different buildings, what projects they've done, those kind of things. So yeah, that's how I try to keep up to date. You got to keep up to date with technology basically. Next question about the balance of creativity. So does your field require creativity? How do you balance between creativity and practicality?
Okay.
I had a doctor tell me, I had two doctors. One told me there's a lot of creativity in being a doctor, and another doctor told me there's zero creativity in being a doctor. So.
In medicine, sometimes you need to be creative.
Really? How
yes.
Is that?
There's this saying, a disease does not read a book, or a patient does not read a book. Sometimes you have to use your knowledge from a book, but you have to employ that knowledge to a specific patient. Like what I said, every patient is unique. So basically, sometimes you need to be creative. There are some things that are not written in the book, and you can say, okay, from my knowledge, I think this one should be 1, 2, 3, 4. You have to be creative. So some of the things that they are not, research is not yet done, but you can use your creativity. Say, okay, this patient, I want to save this patient. I don't read book. The book I thought this, but for this patient, I do this. And then you save that patient. But you have to be careful, because if you do something that is a blunder or a mistake, you can kill that patient. So you have to use your creativity, but make sure you are 100% sure that this one is going to help this patient. But mostly in 95%, we have to work according to guideline. The research is already done. So you have to work according to guideline. But sometimes you have to be creative.
That's interesting.
Yes. I think for you, creativity has a great impact.
See, when you're at university, it's all about creativity. But when you're at work, it's more about practicality. Unless you work for some big, fancy architecture firm, you have the privilege of money to extravagate on these fancy designs, but like that's rarely the case. I think generally architecture is practical, especially in
developing countries for sure. So I think it boils down to working with the client, because the client's spending the money. So if you have regular meetings with the client and show your design every week or every few days, or just communicate with the client, then he can understand, like, oh shit, that's gonna cost too much. Oh, don't do that. I can't do that and stuff. You also get like a quantity surveyor who, consultant usually on, in the project.
Quantity surveyor.
Yeah, he quantifies the design. So he, you give him your drawings and he measures everything, gives, has a rough idea how much it's going to cost.
Okay.
So even if you do a sketch, 1,000 square meter a building, he'll just do a rough calculation. 1,000 square meters, it's roughly like $100 per square meter to build in that area. So that's going to cost that much to build. You've got to make the building smaller. So then you make the building smaller, then you put more detail on the drawing, you have, you draw it like that, and you have windows. Oh, your windows are too, it'll measure the windows, it'll tell you, oh, the windows are too big, make them smaller. Oh, we, I don't really work with a QS, but like.
So that one you should go to school just for quantity surveying.
Yeah, actually in Tanzania, the Architects Registration Board is shared with the Quantity Surveyor.
Okay.
It's called the Quantity Surveyor and Architects Registration Board.
Okay. Oh.
Which is quite interesting. So yeah, basically working with other consultants, working with the client, got to find that balance really. The last question. How does collaboration with professionals contribute to the success in your work, Dr. Mazangi?
Hey, okay. You can answer that first.
One thing I've learned from university and my career, from your earliest sketch when you start designing, get as many people on board as you can from the very early stages. So as soon as you even draw a little sketch, if you can get the builder involved, all the engineers involved, everybody involved to contribute in design, usually that boils down to the success of the project. The earlier you get the consultants, the whole team involved in the project from the early stages, is the more successful the project is. Because you're getting input from everybody from the early stages. That's how important it is to work with other people on the project. How does collaborations with other professionals contribute to the success in your work?
So basically, other professionals. You know, as a doctor, I work with different professionals. A lot of professionals. Like an architect.
Ah, you work with architects.
Yes. Number two, you know, medical service is not for free, because I need to operate, I need to continue buying medicines, I need to pay staff. And accountant, that's another profession that I need, you know. I also need even a lawyer.
Yeah, we have those lawyers. I was thinking more people like other doctors. Like, what about people inside your hospital, those kind of people? Do you help each other at work and collaborate together?
Yes, they have to collaborate.
Because how does it work? Because I've seen like a student come in and see me when they go out, and then 15 minutes later they all come in and they discuss and stuff. And doctors discuss a patient. How does that work?
In medicine, we call it transformation of knowledge. I'm a doctor, and then I have like 10 years experience. I should transform this knowledge and experience and the skills to a younger one, junior one. So, I don't know, sometimes patients come there, they don't want to be touched or seen by a student. How can that? Because I need to transform my knowledge to this. If you don't allow this patient, this student to learn, if after 5 years I'm not there, who's going to treat you? This student should be given time, opportunity to learn.
I quite enjoyed being seen by a student when I was in hospital.
Yes, should be like that. But some patients, they don't like it. They don't like it.
I remember they came in because I had appendix, and she came in and like, she was
touching.
And then
the doctor was,
and then
she
was thinking.
Was it she?
Then she thinking. Then goes. Then she walked out. And then they 10 minutes. They all came in. The doctor and like many other students.
Yes. Because if you are sick, and then a doctor comes there, you if the doctor say you have to remove your clothes, you have to remove your clothes. Yes. Even a president wouldn't come to me and then tell president, you have to remove all the clothes. He's going to remove. That's the power of a doctor.
Right, that brings the end of today's video. I'd just like to say thank you very
man.
Much, Dr.
Thank you
Bezaini.
So much, man. Yeah, it was a nice talk conversation.
I hope you learned something at the end of this. If you decided to choose your career as doctor or architect, I wish you the best of luck. And I'll see you in the next video.